Hey, welcome everybody. I think we can get started with this webinar. I'm Pete Nelson. I'm the Director of Communications at Resources for the Future. Before we get on with the program, I just want to give a few pieces of logistical information before we start talking about this really interesting research on induced earthquakes in Oklahoma. You know, that research was published in the journal Science last week. First of all, you all have two options for audio connection to the webinar: using the microphones and speakers through your computer, or using the call-in number provided by Zoom. If you're having trouble with one option, please try the other, and we'll try to troubleshoot as best we can on our end if there are any problems. So far, we haven't ever had any, but there's always a first time. Second, all of you will be on mute just to prevent any issues with background noise and feedback, but we do want to get your questions, of course, and I encourage you to type those into the Q&A panel on your webinar control interface. And finally, just so you know, this webinar is being recorded and we'll post it to the RFF website, so you'll be able to look at it again later or send the link to others you might think would be interested. So this study we're talking about today is quite interesting and has gotten a fair bit of attention in the media. And you know, for RFF, I think it's a great example of sophisticated research that produces not just new knowledge, but also generates some actionable insights for policy. And that's what we're all about at RFF. Our own Roger Cooke was one of the authors of the study. For this seminar, we're very fortunate to have with us one of Roger's co-authors, Willy Aspinall. Willy is the Cabot Professor in Natural Hazards and Risk Science at the University of Bristol in the UK. He has experience in seismology and volcanology, and recently he's been doing cutting-edge work on expert judgment. And that work has really forged a strong relationship with Roger, who's also an expert in expert judgment. Willy will give a presentation, and then we'll bring in Daniel Ramey for a discussion. Daniel is a senior research associate at RFF and a lecturer in public policy at the Gerald Ford School, the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor. Daniel is also the author of The Fracking Debate, a book recently published by Columbia University Press. It's a great book. It's very accessible and gives a fair look at the major issues surrounding fracking, including the seismology question. I just got my copy yesterday, in fact, and we have a podcast posted on our website today where Daniel and I will discuss the book. So without any further ado, let me turn things over to my friend Willy, who's in England, and Daniel's in Ann Arbor, so we're all spread out all over the place. Okay, take it away, Willy.
Yeah, just a quick brief introduction to the concept of a Bayesian belief network, or a BayesNet. This is a powerful logical way of handling very uncertain data and observations. We use this quite a lot in natural hazards and so on, particularly where we are dealing with, for example, systems with hidden states, and we've had some experience of doing this over the last 15 years or so with erupting volcanoes, where we're unable to actually get into the volcano and measure, say, the magmatic pressure inside. But along the bottom row of the little diagram, you'll see Y1 and Y2 represent observable that may be some things we can detect at the surface in response to changes within the volcano that we can't access. And the approach shown here is a graphical one, often called a directic acyclic graph, because there are unique links between each node and each other node, but they don't complete a complete cycle. So we're interested in a lot of problems in inferring what's going on inside the Earth from things that we can measure at the surface. Next slide, please. This is just an example of how complex the situation is, even with you know, a quite small volcano. This is one in the Caribbean, Montserrat Island, but we've also done similar work on Santorini in the Mediterranean on that. And science these days collects a lot of observations and data, and linking them all together, you know, is what is the real challenge for scientists who've got responsibilities for advising people about future behaviour. And what we've done, next slide please, is taken this sort of approach and applied it to the situation in Oklahoma, where, as everybody will know, there's been a major upsurge in earthquake activity since about 2008, 2009, such that Oklahoma is now probably the most active seismological state in the contiguous US. And the induced seismicity is ongoing there. A couple of days ago, there was a felt earthquake near Hennessy, just south of Enid, magnitude 3.7, and along the bottom row of the diagram, you can see other events that were recorded by the US Geological Survey on the same day in the same area. Next slide, please. This is a infographic to summarize the whole situation. What we've learned in Oklahoma is that induced seismicity, that is earthquakes that are triggered by human activity, are related to the disposal of wastewater from the oil and gas industry. And on the second row, we can see how the number of magnitude 3 earthquakes, and these are big enough to be felt, has grown very substantially, particularly since 2013. And along the right-hand side of that same panel is the annual injection in billions of barrels of waste fluid that has been going on there. The largest earthquake in recent years, 2016 near Pawnee, magnitude 5.8, is the largest earthquake in the history of Oklahoma that we know about. And this is related too to the disposal of waste fluids in the area. Along the bottom row on the left, of particular interest is an enormous national asset, the oil tank farm, and the intersection of multiple pipelines supplying oil and gas around North America at Cushing in Oklahoma. The situation in very simple geological terms is summarized in the lower right panel, in that the geology of Oklahoma is mainly sedimentary strata. Those are deposits laid down in geological time in oceans and rivers, and they sit over what we term the crystalline basement rocks. These are much older rocks that have been metamorphosized into much stronger, more rigid rock material over geological time. On the right-hand side of the panel is a quick summary. There are more than 10,000 active disposal and oil recovery wells in Oklahoma, and 2.3 billion barrels of water are injected underground per year. In the middle of that panel, we have a little graphic showing computer program known as Uninet, which has been developed by our colleague Roger Cooke from RFF and his students at the Technical University of Delft in Holland. And this is a very sophisticated version of a Bayesian belief network. And we have been using that in this study to try and understand the relationships between the well operations in Oklahoma and the geology and the earthquake activity. And the bottom line is that the model we've developed shows that injecting fluid close to the crystalline basement leads to a greater amount of what we call seismic moment release. Most people will be familiar with seismic magnitudes, which are estimates of the size of an earthquake at the source. Earthquake magnitudes are not something that can be added together like feet and inches, but we seismologists convert this to moment release, which is a summary of the total area of a fault that moves in a particular earthquake rupture. And we can sum over the course of time what the total of area of faults has been moving in Oklahoma. So our model works in terms of seismic moment. and it allows us to produce a model that will help operators and regulators decide what's happening in this case. Next slide, please. This is just a quick map showing the area which our study has addressed. Within the black outline is the USGS induced seismicity zone, and this is showing the number of wells that are used for enhanced oil recovery or saltwater disposal in 2011 to 2015. And the coloured hatches below show the main geological features of this particular region. Next slide, please. This is a sort of temperature plot in a way, which shows how much injected volume has taken place, the background colours. So the darker the colour, the more red the colour, the more fluid that has been injected into the ground in those areas. And also superimposed on this are the earthquakes that have been recorded from very small magnitude 2 up to the biggest magnitude 5.8. Near Pawnee, and almost as big earthquake near Prague, 5.6. The key thing to take from this plot is that there is a rough, broad correlation between the amount of injected fluid volume, but it's not a total agreement. Down in the southwest corner of the area, there's an area of quite intense injection, but thus far, this has not been afflicted by the same number of earthquakes as in the north of the area and the northeast of the area. And it's the purpose of our model is to try and understand why certain areas of the region are affected and others seem to be relatively immune to the influence of injected fluid. Next slide, please. This is a bit of a busy map. But what it is summarising is the total seismic moment release in different parts of the USGS seismicity zone, superimposed over a map of the known geological faults. Most of these faults are mapped at the surface of the Earth. We are much less clear about what the fault structure is at depths at which these earthquakes are taking place, and that's typically in the crystalline basement at a depth of about 5 kilometres. So again, our purpose is to try and understand why some faults in the area are sensitive to the impact or the effects of fluid injection, and yet others seem to be relatively immune to it. So these three plots summarise the nature of the data that we're trying to integrate into a single model to understand the processes. Next slide, please. This slide shows on the left-hand side a summary of a simple part of the Bayesian network. Our observable or operation nodes are the yellow outer ones, and our target nodes is in red or pink. And that is what we wish to correlate the annual seismic moment release with these various other factors related to the operational behavior going on in the wells. And we can use this to develop correlations between different factors and the seismic moment release. The larger the number on the arcs, -0.48, -0.43, indicate relatively strong correlation between geospatial correction and earthquake movement and distance from the basement. They're negative values because the further you move away from the basement, the less influential they get. So it's the sign indicates the nature of the relationship in terms of the distance on that. I'll talk a little more about the geospatial correction later because it's one of the unique features of this study. The right-hand panel shows the cumulative annual seismic moment release There's a black line called observations, and the blue line is a simple, ordinary sort of statistical linear regression approach to the problem. That linear regression approach cannot reveal the intricacies of the correlations between different factors and the annual seismic moment release. And the curve marked BN mean, the red line, shows that we can do a better job of matching what is observed using our Bayesian network approach as opposed to conventional linear regression. Next slide, please. Now, this is quite a busy slide and requires a little bit of explanation. One of the things about the Bayesian network is that having inferred what the relationship is between earthquake activity and the geological and operational factors, we can use that model to forecast or see what would happen if we change some of the conditions, say, in the wells. And in this case, on the left-hand side, where it's marked increase in moment, sub-basement wells raised closer to the basement interface, these dots relate to individual wells that have penetrated the crystalline basement. And if we move them upwards towards the top of the basement, we get the spike that increases seismic moment on the left-hand side of this plot. Just to the right are the the greater number of wells that are actually drilled into the Arbuckle formation or above it, that is above the crystalline basement. The color code indicates the volume that's been disposed in each of these wells. And we can see that if we raise those wells to a greater height above the basement, if we plug them in at depth and move the injection upwards, the seismic moment release drops. And that's the downward going spike near zero on the x-axis. The dotted black points are the inference or the average behavior that which is all that linear regression can tell you. It can't tell you about the way different wells will behave under different operational conditions. And this is the unique breakthrough in this particular model, that we are able to do this inferential assessment of the impact of different operating conditions. Next slide, please. Here's an example from the Prague 2011 earthquake. The grey rectangle in the middle delineates what is believed to be the causative fault, and the green upended triangles show the active wells in and around that particular area. A number of studies have been done prior to this where authors considered that wells only within 5 to 10 kilometers of a particular fault may provoke earthquakes, may trigger earthquakes. We've taken a wider catchment area, and more recent work is suggesting this is the right thing to do. And we've looked at the possible influence on that fault of the earthquakes within the large ellipse. Next slide, please, Janine. With our Bayesian network model, we are able to do something really quite interesting. The network is up on the left with similar nodes to the ones that I showed earlier, and with the target node moment in purple. And what we can do with these networks is, with the network, is actually fix the value of an operational condition in any particular well and see how much that contributes to the seismic moment release in its region. So there we've got the data for one well feeding into the target zone, and in the left-hand little box we can see that the that particular well would produce about 17 moment attribution in terms of the log moment from the in terms of earthquakes. on the right-hand box, the little table, we've repeated this exercise for 49 wells within the 20-kilometre radius, and attributed the their own individual contributions to seismic moment release in terms of a percentage normalised over 100. So we can see there that well number one contributes very little to the seismic energy released near Prague, whereas wells number four and 49 contribute about 3% each. And so this Bayesian network technique allows us to look at the contributions of individual wells, given their condition and operational pattern, to the seismic moment release. Next slide, please. I think we've jumped some, haven't we? No, maybe not. Okay. The study that we've reported in Science last week is really just the first step in the analysis that we'd like to do. We need to update it with the most recent seismicity and well operations data. People will be aware that the regulators in Oklahoma, the Oklahoma Corporations Commission, have applied some limits on the amount of fluid that can be injected in the waste wells, and also the drop in the price of a barrel of oil has reduced the amount of waste fluid that's being produced. So we need to update our data to reflect the most recent patterns in that. We also would like to extend our model to include more details about the temporal evolution of the data and the parameters, so that we can track things more in greater detail and thus allow closer coupling with the regulation of the operations there. I mentioned earlier a latent factor called geospatial factor. This is one of the strengths of the Bayesian network approach. We can include in our analysis what's called a latent node or a hidden node, one which takes care of things that we can't get data on very easily, but which we can infer exist. And we've done some checking of this, some training runs to see where in different parts of Oklahoma our model is good at forecasting seismic energy release and where it's not so good. And from those checks on the accuracy of the forecasts, we can make adjustments back into the network to take account of effects which we cannot yet fully understand. But that helps us improve the forecasting behavior of the network. There are other more sophisticated ways of characterizing spatial properties of the earthquake activity in terms of fractal dimension, that is the extent to which one earthquake is linked to a neighboring earthquake as a function of distance. We also are interested in developing criteria for attributing the earthquake activity to individual wells, and this was the original motivation for the study. We were asked about 4 years ago now by an insurance company whether it was possible to devise a way in which they could price their insurance premiums to match the operational properties and behavior of different wells and well operators. So that was the original trigger for us to start this work, but the deeper we got into it, the more interesting we found the geophysical, geological, seismological and operational factors on that. We are also interested in seeing how well our model would work in other areas and under different geological conditions. There are many other parts of the United States and Canada where gas extraction and geothermal field exploitation is going on. And across in Europe, we have a very large gas field in Holland called Groningen, where induced seismicity is becoming a big issue there as a result of the way the field has been exploited. My own background over the years has been in what I call ordinary earthquake hazard assessment for nuclear power stations in US, Britain and elsewhere. And we can see ways in which this very powerful Bayesian network methodology could actually be applied to the determination of hazard levels for things like nuclear power plants and other facilities. So that very quickly and briefly is an attempt to summarize what is really quite a detailed study. There's an awful lot of information in the supplementary online material that accompanies our science paper, and we would very much welcome feedback and comment from colleagues in the earth sciences and other disciplines with a view to making this move forward and be more useful in the future. And I think it's the last slide coming up. Yeah, so thank you for your kind attention, and I hand back to Daniel.
Thank you so much, Willy. That was really fantastic. And I hope that our audience will take your suggestion and look at the paper as well as look at the methods to, you know, get all of the richness that they can out of this really detailed and fantastic work. One question to get us going, just to kind of button up your presentation, and then I will ask a few of my own questions as well as field questions from the audience. So the first question is just to ask you to, you know, once again, can you kind of summarize the overall findings from your paper, sort of give us an abstract at the end of the paper for those who may have joined a little bit late?
Okay, thank you very much, Daniel. Yes, the paper has applied a sophisticated, powerful Bayesian belief network technique developed by the RFF colleague Roger Cooke, his students. And we've used that to analyze the complex and time-varying data from Oklahoma, where activity has been increasing due to injection of waste fluids into the ground. And the primary result we found is that the key factor controlling the earthquake activity at the moment is the depth at which the fluid is injected into the subsurface. And if it's being injected just above the crystalline basement, it has a bigger influence on earthquake activity within the crystalline basement. The crystalline basement, I think it's fair to say, is where the earthquakes are happening. The earthquakes are not a consequence of the energy of pumping fluid into the ground. That is relatively trivial and might produce a few micro earthquakes here and there. What is happening is the fluids are penetrating into the crystalline basement, changing pore pressure conditions near faults that are pre-existing in the crystalline basement and may well be pre-stressed have locked in stresses from the geological past. And what's happening here is just a little fluid injection may be enough to set a fault moving when it's close to critical failure. Many of the people listening may well know that back in 1811, 1812, there were three or four major earthquakes near New Madrid in Missouri, magnitude 7.6, 7.7. Those two are probably not the sort of earthquakes that people usually associate with the San Andreas Fault in California, or with subduction zones along the west coast of the US and South America, but they are probably locked in faults in very ancient geological materials which can be released if somehow they're intruded by fluids or other influences like that. So the important point about our paper is that it's given us some insights into what aspects of fluid disposal are currently influencing seismic activity in Oklahoma. And as I say, the key one that we have honed in on is the fact that if we can reduce the fluid injection close to the basement, it's likely that the amount of earthquake activity will die down. Although we have to be careful, Daniel, about this, because this is a geological process and it operates on a time scale longer than human time scales, and it may be, having started this cascade of fault activity running in the crystalline basement, it may take some time for it to peter out and die down again. And to be blunt, we don't have any good idea whether we're talking months, years, or even decades in that context.
Fascinating. Thank you for that. So we're getting questions sent in to us through various forums. I would encourage our participants to continue sending in those questions. We are keeping track of them, and we will get to as many of them as we can. One question that you hinted at during your presentation that I'd like to ask you about in a little more detail is this question of the relative effects of new regulations enacted by the Oklahoma Corporation Commission relative to the effects of lower oil prices, which has led to less oil drilling, which in turn leads to less wastewater production. And so does your model tell us much, or do you have any thoughts on the relative contribution of those two factors to the reduced earthquake activity we've seen in Oklahoma over the last several years?
We don't at the moment, Daniel, but in principle, we could include that in the Bayesian network formulation. We could add a node that said, what's the price of oil? It's a variable which is affecting activity in Oklahoma. We could add another node which would be regulatory changes on that. And once we can accumulate a little bit of data, a few months, maybe a year of data, we can start to get a feel for how much those are influencing factors as well. So in principle that could be done, but as you'll appreciate, we earth scientists generally don't get involved in things like economics and regulation influences, but I guess as a policy specialist you would be very interested in pursuing that. And I recommend you talk to Roger Cooke about this, as the sort of guy who's got a great deal of lateral thinking.
That's a great suggestion, and I know certainly myself, and I imagine many others on this webinar today are thinking along the same lines, so we'll be banging down Roger's door soon, I'm sure. Another question relates to a detail in the paper that I don't think you expanded on in your brief presentation here, but in the paper, you talk about how the model primarily relies on data aggregated at the monthly level related to wastewater injection, as well as seismic activity. And one of the questions that I had early on was, you know, could we get more insights from more finely resolved data? So if we were to look at daily injection volumes or even hourly injection volumes, would that give us additional insight into the processes going on and help inform policymakers? Or because of the geologic timescales that we're thinking about with this question, is it not really necessary to get into that level of granularity?
My instinctive response is that, anything more sampled more frequently than weekly or monthly is going to be too much detail. Of course, you're going to increase the amount of data hugely on this. We are dealing with a geological process, and from the way activity built up from 2008, 2009 through 2013, 2015, 16, I think it's pretty fair to say this is a geological process with a timescale of months to years on that. I should also add that there's a huge challenge in actually getting this sort of data, the well logging data and the reports on disposal data, cleaned up. There's a lot of noise in it. It relies on self-reporting by operators. And for example, one complication in this is that there have been some oil wells that have played out, become exhausted, and have been converted to disposal wells since. So, there are a lot of subtle games being played in this whole industry, and tracking them, on a time scale faster than, say, every month would be a huge challenge and would present us with data handling problems as well.
Yeah, that makes sense. One more question from me, and then I'm going to start pulling from some of our audience questions. This question has to do with generalizability of your findings that focus on Oklahoma. So you talk in the paper about how the Arbuckle group, where most of this wastewater is being injected, is connected through a variety of mechanisms to the crystalline basement, which allows for communication between those two zones. I'm wondering what information we have in Oklahoma, as well as in other states in the United States, or perhaps even internationally, so you can take this question as local or as global as you would like. How much information do we have about other wastewater disposal regions and their proximity or connectivity to basement rocks where earthquakes could occur? So to put it in other words, do we have good data about the connections between wastewater disposal zones and places where earthquakes might happen? Data that could actually allow regulators to act with better information about how to prevent these risks.
Oh, that's going to be another huge challenge, I'm afraid, Daniel. The situation in Oklahoma, geologically speaking, is really a rather simple one. We've got very clearly layered strata, sedimentary strata, over a very clear, well-defined crystalline basement. And the structure is relatively simple. In many other parts of the world, structures are much more complicated. Our knowledge of them at those sort of depths is quite limited. We have extensive geophysical data on faults and near surface geology in many places in the world. Once you start getting down to the depths at which earthquakes occur, 5 kilometers or even deeper, we are really starting to approach the inaccessible earth. And to be blunt, the history of seismology, and this is true of California as much as anywhere, in recent years, most of the big recent earthquakes in the last 2 or 3 decades in California have popped up on faults which hadn't been previously mapped and weren't really known as faults, these blind thrusts and hidden thrusts, for example. And this has also been the case in Oklahoma. Some of them have occurred, some of the bigger ones have occurred. Then we've gone and looked and said, oh yes, well of course, there's a bit of a fault structure here on that. The other complication that's been a bit of an eye-opener for seismology in the last year was a major earthquake in New Zealand, the Kaiakura earthquake, which was magnitude 7.5 or so, which actually ruptured, I think it's 13 or 15 individual fault segments. This wasn't a single traceable fault like the San Andreas. It's a faulted zone. And in that particular earthquake last year, a rupture started on one segment and it jumped to the next and the next and the next and, in rapid succession, and produced, a big felt earthquake comprising lots of actually sub-earthquakes in essence. And the same was true of the big Tohoku earthquake off Japan with the Fukushima disaster. There's evidence there that it wasn't a single segment of the subduction zone that ruptured, but in fact 3 segments, one after the other. So what I'm trying to convey here is that we don't really have a good handle on the deep structure of the Earth where earthquakes occur. And it's pretty tricky to say, well, here's a candidate fault, let's watch this one closely, because Mother Nature says, oh, you're watching that, I'll make something else go off. And, you know, that's the situation. So the conditions in Oklahoma are very favourable in simple geological terms for this particular process. There are other areas of the world, at the Groningen field in Holland, they have very extensive geophysical data on it. It's been in operation for 30 years or so, and they know that extremely well. But many parts of the Earth's surface, you know, we don't know a great deal about what's down there.
Yeah, that's fascinating. So another reason for us to be humble about what we know and what we don't. And I know in the United States there is at least some efforts underway in states like Texas to try to gather a better understanding of subsurface to help prevent these issues in the future. But it sounds like there's an enormous amount of work to do, and that uncertainty will remain going forward. So pulling from some of our audience questions, and again, I'd encourage our webinar participants to continue submitting the questions. We're monitoring them in real time. One question that has come in is kind of a three-part question. So so this might take a minute for me to spit out, but I think all three parts are connected. The first part of the question is kind of a simple question. So a policymaker might read your paper or listen to this webinar, and they might come away with an idea, a simple idea, that, okay, so if we just restrict injection to X feet above the basement, then we're safe, or, you know, we're in good shape. Would that be an appropriate message to take away from today's webinar? So that's question one. The second related part is, in Oklahoma in particular, do you and your co-authors through this research, or do you know if policymakers and folks in the Oklahoma Geological Survey or the Oklahoma Corporation Commission, do they have good information about where the most risky places are today? Obviously they have gone forward with some restrictions on injection in certain regions. Are they doing that based on robust information, or is it a little bit, or are they working with limited data? The final piece of this question is, if regulators or industry or other actors were to decide to begin injecting in other areas rather than these places that have caused the problems, if they injected into shallower zones, is there a potential for those shifting locations of injection to actually trigger new activity, new seismic activity in those new areas? So I know that's a lot to handle. Feel free to take as much or little of that as you feel appropriate, but that's our question.
Okay, I'll try my best with that, Daniel, yes. In terms of policymakers and considering applying some stricter constraints on operations and so on, will it make it safe? I don't think we can guarantee that. We can be fairly sure that the level of activity will drop back a bit, but having set this thing going, I don't think we can guarantee that it won't happen. An analogy I like to use for, well, particularly for older viewers and listeners, is that, you know, in the good old days, automobile windscreens, if they cracked, they used to craze. The whole thing used to, you know, shatter. And this is what's happening in the Earth's crust. Of course, technical advances mean they got rid of that problem, and screens now don't do that anymore. So having set the Earth moving like this, the policy makers may be able to reduce the chances of bigger or more damaging earthquakes, but it won't be a guaranteed exercise on that. Do they have sufficient information to try and regulate this and so on? Well, I think the more data we get, the more we understand the processes and the more we can refine them in terms of local behaviour, they will be better able to do this. So what the our study provides is at least a quantitative basis for judging whether to reduce the depth of injection and by how much. Prior to this study, I think it's fair to say it would have been an arbitrary, well, let's raise it by 100 feet, 200 feet, how many hundred feet was just a judgment. We now provide a quantitative basis for saying, you know, how much bang you'll get for your buck in terms of that. And in terms of moving to other areas, again, we won't know until the experiment is restarted. If you start injecting in a new area, in a different state or a different part of the eastern US, for example, we won't know until we start doing it just what will happen there. It may be that Oklahoma was particularly favourable for this to happen and that other areas are less susceptible to this. But we can't, it would be very difficult to judge that on our basic state of knowledge of the Earth's crust and its stress conditions at depth.
Yeah, thank you. And one data point just to point out to our audience who, you know, our focus on the Oklahoma example, Willy and your colleagues in the study, you focus on Oklahoma. It's worth noting that there have been wastewater related earthquakes in other states in the United States over the last 5-10 years. They have generally been much smaller in number and smaller in size than the largest quakes we've seen in Oklahoma. So Oklahoma is, you know, is not indicative of what's happening in all the other shale plays in the United States. But indeed, there are implications that we should and can take from what's happening in Oklahoma. One question that I find particularly intriguing, and I'm not sure if you would want to comment on this. You noted that part of the initial motivation for this project came from questions from insurance companies. Now in Oklahoma, that there has been this seismicity and there has been damage incurred, there are people who are interested in lawsuits and interested in suing those who they may deem responsible for that damage. Does your work provide basis for evidence that could be used in litigation? Is that something you've thought about? Is that a how do you think about the potential application of your work to that area?
Yes, we've thought about it. Indeed, as I said earlier, this was the original motivation to start studying the activity with the Bayesian network approach was a question from an insurance firm on that. Attribution of blame, if you want to put it this way, it's not just restricted to induced seismicity and wastewater disposal, of course. It's a topic in climate change and, you know, in more extreme weather, storms and the like. How much can we attribute those to climate change and so on? I think what we can say is that our sort of analysis provides a perspective on it. I don't think it's necessarily going to provide, you know, a definitive, unquestionable answer. It's going to give us a hint of what we think is happening. And one of the interesting aspects of this in terms of litigation, because I've seen one of the colleagues has asked about this, is that this sort of approach based on Bayesian statistical thinking has not made much headway in courts of law. I'm not so sure about in the States, but in Britain, we've had some pretty notorious cases with DNA evidence where the judges have basically refused to allow statisticians to present even a hint of the evidential worth of observations, measurements, DNA matches, for example, on that. So this sort of approach, as far as I know, has never yet reached a court of law, and it would be an extremely interesting experience to see, you know, how it is handled by lawyers when it comes to that sort of thing. So yes, we think this provides an insight, but not a, you know, definite yes, no, black and white answer to the question. So it's a proportionate attribution to different wells that we can do. It's easier in some ways because you've got so many wells in Oklahoma that, you know, their contributions are going to be spread out amongst them. It would be a different matter if you were dealing with a single disposal well. I think there was a case a year or two ago, was it the Mineral earthquake, which related to a disposal well near a nuclear power station in northeast US. It caused ground acceleration that exceeded the design level for the power station, and that was attributed to a single waste disposal well. I think it was the Mineral earthquake. I may be not, I would need to look it up. But again, sooner or later, I suspect this will enter litigation and will be a huge challenge for the scientists and statisticians and probabilists to make a case that lawyers are happy with.
Yeah, that makes sense. I know there's at least one case in Ohio from, I want to say, 2011, where there was a seismic event that was attributed, at least by regulators, quite clearly to one particular wastewater disposal well. So we have had a couple examples of that type of thing in the world of oil and gas. I'm not familiar with the nuclear example you cited.
It may have been that same Ohio earthquake, I think, yes. And there is, of course, a long history of this going back to military disposal wells, Rocky Mountain Arsenal, back in the 50s. They pumped fluid down and earthquakes started happening, stopped pumping, and the earthquake stopped again. So this isn't at all novel in a way. We know about other cases in Russia, the Gazli oil field, gas field, where very large earthquakes were prompted by winning the gas and extracting it.
Great. So we've got just a few minutes left, so maybe I'll ask the final question on behalf of one of our, one of our guests. Let's see. So the question is, can you talk a little bit about what we know and what we don't know about why has this problem occurred at such scale in Oklahoma and been virtually non-existent in other places where there's a lot of oil and gas wastewater injection, such as, say, the Bakken in North Dakota, or maybe the Eagle Ford in South Texas, or you know, some other oil and gas producing regions of the US. We haven't seen this problem, at least not anywhere near the scale we've seen it in Oklahoma. Can you give us just a little insight into why that might be?
Well, yes, if I knew the answer to that, I'd be a wealthy man. I suspect it's a combination of very favorable geological conditions and stresses there and the huge volume of wastewater that's been disposed of in Oklahoma. I think it's fair to say that some people confuse this with fracking, where fluids are injected to open up pathways for oil and gas recovery. The evidence that's available suggests that fracking is a very minor component in this, that it is the wastewater which is being disposed of at greater depths than the oil and gas deposits are being recovered from. So the combination of a very large injection of a great deal of fluid into an area that is, you know, sensitive is probably what's created this very interesting experiment.
Yeah. All right, great. So thank you for a very interesting, I wouldn't call it an experiment, but a very interesting presentation today, helping us understand this really important research, which I think is, we can tell by the large number of participants we have, of very much interest to lots of people out there. The last thing that I will say before handing it back over to Pete and Janine is this presentation will be available on the Resources for the Future website at rff.org/events. So if you would like to share today's presentation with your colleagues or your friends and family, check out the website, and we'll have additional information there for you to consume. So thank you again, Willy, so much for joining us, and thank you to all of our participants online. And I will sign off and turn it back over to Pete and Janine.
Thank you, Dan.
Okay, well, thanks very much for joining us. As Dan mentioned, we are gonna post this on our website, and really appreciate your questions and attention. And if you have any feedback, you can send it to me, Nelson@rff.org, and how we can improve this process and these webinars. And again, thanks very much. Bye.
Bye, Donnie.